Quality Radio.
Hello and welcome. This is Five Round MMA. My name is Alex Ramirez. Alongside me is my co-host, Albert Cedar. We're also joined on the phone in the East Coast, from the East Coast, our other correspondent, Guillermo Cedar. How's it going, guys?
Good. It's going well, man. Pro Bowl weekend over here in Orlando.
Oh, yeah?
What's going on?
That's something to get hyped up about, right?
How many of your fantasy team members are on the Pro Bowl this year, Guillermo?
To be honest with you, I don't know. I didn't check that. But they, you know, the where they're holding up the skills challenge is like 5 minutes from my house.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
I get a busy weekend for that stuff. Also, this weekend's I think the NHL All Star Game, which is actually in our LA Staples Center, I believe. So that's
cool. Justin Bieber get boarded against the board.
that's worth the price of admission, I think.
Keep it going too, because it's also Royal Rumble weekend.
You got
as well.
Royal Rumble weekend for you wrestling fans out there.
And don't forget UFC Fight.
UFC Fight Night. Took place this past Saturday, UFC on Fox in Denver, Colorado, which we spend the majority of our show on. We're going to go over that card. Basically, the three main bouts also go into some Fight Night preview for next weekend and talk about what's up with these champions and why not wanting to defend their title and just want to get the big money fights. Are they right or are they wrong in asking for that? But let's get started with round number one. Albert, got the timer going?
I actually have it ready this time.
Ready? And count us down. Timer's going. So round number one, UFC Fight Night in Denver, Colorado. UFC on Fox, main event between a bantamweight title eliminator match between Valentina Shevchenko and Julianna Pena. It was kind of going clear that the winner would get a title shot at Amanda Nunes, and it was Valentina. Much to a lot of people's surprise, well, maybe not to the surprise, but how she did it.
I wasn't surprised.
How she won it, because Valentina, or nicknamed Bullet, is a known striker. Well, I think behind Alistair Overeem, probably the second most decorated striker in the UFC, I think, right? Just from her kickboxing championships and all that stuff like that. She's a well-established striker coming in the UFC, but she scored a submission win over, I think, Pena describes as a grappler, right? She's a grappler,
and
wrestler.
She's supposed to be the queen of the ground.
Yeah, so...
The ground queen.
Yeah, so basically this is a... A surprise on how she did it for Valentina. Just guys on thoughts and reactions on how this fight broke down.
Well, I'll take it first.
Yeah.
And okay. let's get the elephant. I always like to remove the elephant out of the room first.
First thing, yeah.
That was the most horrible trash talking I ever saw after the fight. When they brought Amanda Nunes up to, I guess, push the fight, that thing was horrendous. These guys need a Paul Heyman. It was so horrible hearing these guys talk smack. But with that said... Man, what a shocker. As soon as I saw Julia Pena finally get that top position, the first thing I thought was like, oh, so this fight's over. But I thought Julia Pena was going to finish the fight. I didn't think it was going to happen like that. And I think it was one of those things where one fighter prepares more than the other, and then the other one kind of forgets about their strength. Almost like the whole Josh Koscheck GSP thing where he didn't train wrestling and he didn't even really factor in the wrestling. And that's ultimately was the deciding factor. I think this was the same thing.
Yeah, that's a little ironic, too. If anybody watched the Road to the Octagon special leading up to this fight, they highlighted Pena and how she actually lives with her jiu-jitsu coach.
Yeah. and if you live with your jiu-jitsu coach, you shouldn't be getting arm-barred.
Yeah, she gets arm-barred for the loss. But Guillermo said, I saw this kind of off-topic, but like seeing the evolution of these bantamweight fighters and how well-rounded they are, you know, we have a striker in Valentina getting submission wins. To me, it just seems like this division is moving further and further away from like Ronda Rousey, right? I mean,
I really do think so. I mean, like I think there's emerging stars that we didn't know because of Ronda Rousey. You know, before it felt like it was the same girls, and we're just gonna reshuffle them to Ronda Rousey, the Kat Zaganos, the Misha Tate. I mean, it felt like a revolving door, but I mean, now the Julia Pena's, I can't even pronounce her name.
Shevchenko.
Shevchenko. I think that, and Amanda Nunes, I think it's a good new breed of women's MMA in the bantamweight division.
And just some irony to throw onto here. Remember how Julia Pena kept saying that she wanted to face Ronda Rousey and that she thought she was a bad match for Rousey? Apparently, she was the bad matchup because if she got arm-barred by Valentina, I'm pretty sure she would have got arm-barred by Ronda Rousey. So maybe she did not have the ingredients to beat Ronda Rousey.
I mean, go ahead, Guillermo.
I was going to say, the other thing, too, is, you know, Albert talked about the trash talk of Valentina.
Horrible.
I think that plays I think that plays well for Valentina. I think she's very underrated. I mean, like, you know, everybody says stand up. But, you know, as I watched the fight, I was really, really impressed by Valentina, her patience, and kind of just like, you know, to me, it felt like even though Julia Pena had her against the fence, it's like she was strategizing how she was going to overcome all this. And I was more impressed by Valentina not just giving away to, you know, the grappling and the wrestling. And that she was composed the whole entire time. But, I mean, I think Valentina is, like, to me, it can be Amanda Nunes easily if it goes any, you know, even striking, if it stays striking, I think Valentina's very, very, she's very textbook. I think that's the word I was looking for. She's very textbook, and I like that about her.
She's like almost like the equivalent of like a Mighty Mouse. But, I mean, for Valentina, she's been overlooked. I mean, nobody knew who she was when she fought Holly Holm, and then all of a sudden she destroys her for 5 rounds. And like, who is this? And then, no, she's pretty legit. And then now, oh, you know, she lost a close decision to Amanda Nunes. Now she kind of just went through Julianna Pena. I mean, this could be, you know, the start of the
making. It's just crazy to think that that belt is probably going to be handed again. So that's like, no one has ever done a title defense yet, huh?
Yeah, it's like the light heavyweight championship back in the day. But so, as far as Pena goes, I think she does have some growing to do. I know she has some issues outside of the octagon. Yeah, you know, she had a legal issue last year, and then remember she had that random weird accident where, what did she, like, horse playing with her teammate and, like, blew out her knee, right?
Nah, I heard she got assaulted by her teammate.
Really?
That's the way I heard the story.
But I think she's not going to, it's just a minor setback, and she'll be back at it again. So that's it for round number one. We'll come back and talk about exactly, will the real Donald Cerrone please stand up? That's the question I want to ask the coming up round. But before we do that, I want to talk about one of our great sponsors, our great friends, 5 Rounds clothing line. 5 Rounds offers a unique collection of MMA apparel and accessories by incorporating the culture, style, and attitude of mixed martial arts. They are constantly evolving by improving to becoming the best fightwear company possible in the MMA world. So check out their line of t-shirts, hoodies, hats, and other good accessories at 5rounds.clothing. They're also on Twitter and Instagram at 5roundswear. For Twitter, it's number 5roundswear. And on Instagram at 5rounds. They dropped us a couple some fresh new beanies out there, man. I didn't get one of those things. Maybe we could kick butt real quick. I'll wear it on the show.
Please.
So 5 rounds, get it on. Round number 2 coming up. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back. Time for round number 2. So I'm asking a question, Albert. Once you get the timer started.
Ding, ding, ding.
Round number 2 official. Who is the real Donald Cerrone? Can you answer that?
A very inconsistent fighter.
Inconsistent fighter. This is a guy who was coming off of, what, 4 straight wins? Coming to Saturday, UFC on Fox, against Jorge Masvidal. Alex Oliveira, Patrick Cote, Rick Story, Matt Brown, all finishes, 3 TKOs, 1 submission, and he loses very badly to Jorge Masvidal. And I think the debate now is that I knock him out twice in the fight because that stoppage in the first round. So Masvidal saying actually knocked him out twice. Cowboy Cerrone seems to be the guy. He's a fan favorite. The fans love him. UFC loves him, but whenever he gets close to any type of real competition, well, I don't think Masvidal is real competition for him, but he seems to choke under the pressure, I guess. I don't know what it is, or he lays an egg.
I mean,
he laid an egg against Dos Anjos. Remember when he fought him back in 2015? He laid an egg when he fought him again. That weird fight with Anthony Pettis got finished. He laid an egg against Nate Diaz back in the day. So what? He obviously is in championship material. He's already in his mid-30s. If you either get it now, you never get it, right?
I don't think he's going
to
get it.
Mentally, anyways.
I use the incorrect word of inconsistent because for the most part, you know, he does get win streaks.
Yeah.
I just think he folds under the bright, the big lights. I think that's when you see I wouldn't say the real Donald Cerrone because the real Donald Cerrone wouldn't have those type of performances, but like you said, he kind of lays an egg when the pressure gets, you know, more intense, the lights get brighter, you know, the pressure of the fight or the what's at stake, it seems he kind of folds. I mean, like you saw against I like to think back against Anthony Showtime Pettis. I mean, like it seemed like it wasn't the same Donald Cerrone against Masvidal yesterday. It didn't seem like the same Donald Cerrone that we're expecting.
This was a big deal for him. This was his hometown, Denver, Colorado. He grew up there. If you watch the Octagon, he was doing a bunch of press. He was like up on every TV show, every radio station possible to promote this fight. And other than he was the co-main event, maybe that's what it was. Albert, do you think it's just like
I want to say was that, because to tell you the truth, I mean, again, we in no way would I ever say I know how to fight. Yeah. But it's easy to understand the basics of anything, even though you don't practice it or not. And it really seemed like Don Cerrone was not moving, right?
Yeah.
He was, like, staying in the pocket. It didn't really – it didn't seem like the Don Cerrone previously that fought Matt Brown, Rick Story, you know, where he was a little bit more – I don't know. There's more movement to it.
Yeah.
So
I think it goes beyond that, Albert, to be honest with you. It just from the minute the bell rang, the confidence level wasn't there to –
Yeah, but
with Donald Cerrone.
Yeah, and that's what I'm trying to say. It didn't feel like he was ever in the fight, and it's the same thing like when Ronda Rousey lost to Amanda Nunes. It just feels like these people were never in the fight to begin with for some odd reason, whether it be mental, something physical. But you can tell when a fighter is clearly not in the fight.
Yeah, I think like just Cerrone, like he's a murderer of like guys like 8 through 20. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
because. I mean, Rick Story, Patrick Cote, they're not really knocking on the door for contenders. He murders them all. Even Matt Brown, people are starting to see what he really is. But then, like, he gets that step up in competition. A guy's maybe on his level or maybe just a peg below or a peg above him. He always lays an egg, which is kind of frustrating. Like, we see how good you are, man. So, like, why are you – I never see such a big gap between guys. Like, there's this big gap between everybody below him and then everybody above him. It's like this weird thing that nobody
– It's crazy.
It's weird.
But the only good thing to look at now is he's never had back-to-back losses.
Yeah.
And after a loss, he usually goes on a good little streak. So maybe
it depends who he fights, though.
Maybe we'll see a cowboy streak again.
If they're going to give him 16 through 20 in the welterweight division, what's the point of it all? I mean, yeah, he's collecting paychecks. Is there any money? You know, great for him. But he was talking about, like, oh, getting the championship to be my year. I mean, and a loss to Jorge Masvidal isn't really going to, you know, get you any closer to title shot. As for Masvidal, too, he's kind of the same way. He's kind of like he's consistently entertaining, but like as far as like you know putting this performances where he's closer to a title shot, he's not anywhere near.
You feel sure with Benson Henderson or Renz Larkin?
Yeah. So I mean, that's just me. But Cerrone, man, come on, man. I always pick his win too, and I always get bite in the butt.
And I always pick against him.
Yeah. He's usually a sure bet.
I always feel like, man, how could you bet against Donald Cerrone?
I mean, if it was a championship fight, I would never bet for Donald Cerrone.
Yeah, that's true. But for Masvidal, he had recent losses over Renz Larkin, Benson Harrison, and Ali
Quinta. Oh, split decision.
But he's on a three-fight win streak against Ross Pearson, Jake Ellenberger. That weird thing with Jake Ellenberger, man, he got his toe caught. And then now Donald Cerrone, so let's see who he calls out next. Did he call anybody after the fight?
He just told Dana White to give him somebody in the top five.
So
and you know, given his performance against Donald Cerrone, I was pretty impressed by Masvidal. I mean, like, you stated it the best. It was kind of like two guys kind of in the same type of mix where it's like they're highly, you know, they're given their talent.
Yeah.
Everybody expects highly of these two guys, and both of them can't get over the hump. So. Yeah. I want to see Masvidal now. Let's see if he did get over the hump with this win over Donald Cerrone.
I mean, interesting. He can talk smack.
There's plenty of interesting fights out there. 170. Robbie Lawler is available. There's plenty of fights out there.
Yeah, plenty of fights out there. So we got one more round to talk about UFC Fight Night in Denver, Colorado. That's a heavyweight division. Guillermo's going to go deep into his boy, Francis Ngannou.
Predator!
There you go. But before we do that, I want to talk about one of our great sponsors and great partners over at Rockin Green. Rockin Green is an award-winning manufacturer of eco-friendly cleaning products designed to make cleaning easier and greener. I'm all about the easy green life. Rockin Green products are all natural and made with biodegradable plant-based ingredients. Visit rockingreen.com for more information. Just shop their great line of products. They're also on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Rockin Green. Get it clean. Coming up, round number three. Time for round number three. So we're going to end our conversation about the UFC Fight Night in Denver this past Saturday with the heavyweight matchup between Francis Ngannou and Andre Arlovski. So this is heavy division. If you guys have listened to the show in the past, is we talk about this a lot because it's one of our favorite divisions. I mean, you can't be a combat sports fan and not love the heavyweight division, whether it be boxing or anything else, even wrestling. Heavyweight's where they're at.
Of course.
But in the past couple of years, the UFC heavyweight division has been very lacking in development, especially of its future. I mean, Guillermo, can you give me a list of the UFC heavyweight prospects from ages like 25 to 27 to maybe 32? Is there a gap around there of like, is there like a core of young guys of like coming up? Can you look back at those guys in their future right there?
Get in the chopper. Just a predator.
Yeah, he was 30.
I mean, what's his name? Derek Lewis or Derek?
Yeah, the Black Beast, which I don't fuck up.
The Black Beast. I don't know how old he is. You know, I think Anthony Hamilton. Derek Lewis is
31.
Stefan Struve. I mean, the list is very, very thin. But, you know, now that I think about it, I was actually thinking about, like, why don't we have young prospects in the heavyweight division? Like, you know, a 22-year-old, 23-year-old. I think the real reason is they're in other sports.
Yeah.
When you can get a 6'4", 6'5", guy at, like, you know, 260 range, and that, I mean, that's light.
They're a linebacker.
They're probably playing in the NFL, or they're probably playing some other type of very, very high-level athlete, because those are hard to come by. I mean, to find a 6'4", 6'5", guy, I mean, those don't come around too often. So I think that's part of the reason, and that's why you see it towards the end or a little bit older, because once they don't become successful and what, or, you know, it's towards the end of their career, the other sport they're doing, and I'll just use the NFL as an example. Matt Mitrione.
Yeah.
So you have an NFL prospect.
Well, if you look at that whole Ultimate Fighter cast, half of them were, like, practically NFL players.
Didn't Brandon Schwab try to
be
NFL?
Yeah, Brandon Schwab was supposedly in the NFL. What's his name? Marcus, whatever. Yeah. There's a bunch of guys that were NFL players.
Yeah, but, and, you know, the NFL, given the hits and, you know, how physical demanding it is, I think, you know, their life shelf, let's say towards the end of their, you know, because you got young kids coming out of college at, you know, 22, 21-year-old, these guys at 28, 29, 30 are finally leaving the NFL and give it a chance in mixed martial arts, so that you get a 30-year-old and only, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 fights, and they're already in the UFC.
Yeah,
if they can master the stand-up. I mean, like, if you think about it, when have we really seen a jiu-jitsu fight in the heavyweight division?
Yeah.
Nogueira versus Frank Mir?
Yeah.
I mean, that's the last one I can remember. Yeah. I mean, so I think that's part of it. I think, you know, these guys are special in terms of size, and you can't teach size. You can teach skill, you know, like other aspects.
Yeah.
And so I think that's part of the reason. But going back to the Predator, he's a future champ, man. I see it. I see the writing on the wall. I mean, I told you guys before the fight even started, depending on how he did against Arlovski, I was going to determine whether he was going to be a champion or not. Like, I knew he was good, but is he championship caliber material? I think he is. I think this guy versus Stipe Miocic, you're asking for fireworks. I think that's the money-making fight. At heavyweight division.
I think for Francis, I think the two nearest guys in age-wise to him are Dos Santos, who's 32, and then Cain Velasquez, who's 34. But those two guys have been, like, injury plagued these past couple of years. So they're a rough 32 and a rough 34. Current champion Stipe Miocic is also 34. But former champion Verdum, I think, was 39, 37. Yeah. Guys like Mark Hunt, who's still in the contenders, like, 42, 40. Roy Nelson's 40, Arlovski, who you just beat, is 37 years old. So these guys are up there. And the other sport, you know, like in basketball, Kobe Bryant was called a dinosaur at 36.
Yeah.
And, you know what I mean? So it's like, but it's a great point you say. Like, you know, there aren't, like, even if you go, like, to the smaller levels, the Bellators, the LFAs, the King of the Cage, there's not that many young guys who are heavyweight prospects in those organizations.
And not true heavyweights. Come on, let's keep it real, guys. When we see a heavyweight bout in another organization, they're a little Roy Nelson-ish.
Yeah. So I mean, I think the road is paved for Francis there if he can just keep it, you know, keep on the level, getting a higher, not a big jump in competition, but a small jump here and there. And by who knows?
No.
You want him, like, give him JDS. JDS next?
Nope, this is the path, Alex. You give Ngannou maybe someone in the top five.
JDS.
But leave JDS out. Leave Verdum out.
Leave him out of this.
Okay, and leave Stipe out. You give Ngannou someone else besides and Cain Velasquez out. So you leave those four guys out, right?
There's nobody left. you just eliminated like three of the top five.
Okay, so then there's out of those four guys, you have someone else, right?
Yeah, Ben Rothwell.
No, don't give him Ben Rothwell. Right? Give him the winner out of Ben Rothwell versus Travis Browning. Is that the next fight?
I think so.
Yeah.
Okay, you give that fight to Ngannou, right?
Yeah.
Then that, to me, skip everybody else for Ngannou and go straight to Stipe Miocic. Stipe Miocic versus Ngannou. And then you get in the, at least if this is the guy that's really going to be as highly touted or highly watched as I think he will be, then you give him Ngannou one at a time. You give him Verdum. You give him JDS. You give him Cain Velasquez, and you set up the legacy of the Predator.
So here he's already in the after last night's win. After Saturday's win, he's already in the top 10 already. So in front of him, he has number 9, Travis Browning, number 8, Derek Lewis, number 7, Arlovski, who just
doesn't
beat.
Doesn't make sense.
Number 6, Mark Hunt, number 5, Ben Rothwell.
There you go.
4, like JDS, 3, Oscar Reem, 2, Cain Velasquez, number 1.
I like that even better. Give him the Reem. Reem versus Ngannou, and that eliminates Reem because I think, given his track record, he's very inconsistent. So you give him the Reem, and then Ngannou versus Stipe Miocic, and you give them one at a time, and every fight from there on out is fresh and a high-level pay-per-view buying type of fight, because who's going to take down Ngannou? Who's going to defeat the Predator if he's able to get through Stipe Miocic?
We need, like, another dominant heavyweight. The sport's always healthy when there's a heavyweight division in there. Hopefully we shall see. Hopefully that. That's it for round number 3. We'll take a small break and come back and enter the championship rounds. I want to talk about what's going on with all these fighters ducking the number of contenders in their division. Just want the big money fights, but there's no big money fights out there. And we're also preview the, Bermudez versus Korean Zombie coming up in a couple weeks as well, too. So do not go anywhere. But before we do that, I want to take time here to talk about one of our great partners in Redemption Martial Arts. Redemption Martial Arts Foundation is a nonprofit organization with the primary goal of bringing awareness to the bullying epidemic and providing people with accessible resources and training to help them combat confrontations. Team RMA consists of individuals from all walks of life who share a common passion for making a difference and serving as anti-bullying activists. If you're interested in being a member of the RMA team or just want some more information, please visit redemptionmartialarts.com. That's redemptionmartialarts.com. They're also on social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, all that good stuff. Again, redemptionmartialarts.com. Rise up against bullying. We're going to take a small break. Enter the championship rounds coming up next. Welcome back. Time to enter the championship rounds, round number 4. I want to talk about a little topic here. I'm going to read a quote from a current UFC champion, and you guys want to just guess who it is. So, quote, "I want the biggest fight I can get. I don't mind facing number one contenders, but at this stage of my career, I fought the best guys forever. I want the biggest fight it can be possibly be, and by biggest, I mean the biggest money-generating fight I can possibly have. I feel I deserve that. I've earned that," end quote. Guillermo, can you guess who that is?
Dude, you told us before the break.
Oh, did I?
Michael Bisping.
So, Michael Bisping, this is a guy, I mean, since he won the championship day one, he said that I call the shots now and I want to fight who I want to fight. But it's not also Michael Bisping. I mean, Tyron Woodley had a pretty profound statement saying that he's been the most unfair treated champion, and that he's calling racism on this. That he, because the reason why he didn't really get the big money fight, why he's fighting Wonderboy, is because it's racism, and that he feels that the UFC has a great opportunity with him as being an African American champion. Which is kind of true, but dude, you just won the belt, man. I mean,
and get out of here. DC is the current champion. Don't give me.
Yeah, and then John Jones can be treated very well.
If anything, I thought John Jones was treated too well for
himself.
And then Demetrius Johnson too, but also Amanda Nunes was already calling like, "No, I want to be the first ever women 2-time champion. I want to face the winner of Holly Holm and I keep forgetting who she's fighting, but." And then, like, even before the Valentina and Pena fight, so yeah.
And even Cody was trying to get that McGregor fight.
Yeah, even before he even wins the fight. So I understand these guys want to make more money. I understand, I'm all for that. The more money they make, what they say, higher water raises all boats. But man, can we get a no more contender up in here? I mean, how many Jacques do we have? Damian Maia and Jacques, look at they're just floundering in the division.
Poor Damian Maia.
Poor Jacques too. They got to fight guys like Tim Boesch just to get a paycheck while these other guys are running around trying to get big money fights with each other. I mean, that whole debacle between Woodley and Michael Bisping, it's super fight nobody wants to see. But Guillermo, is this all because of one Conor McGregor? I mean, does everybody see themselves as a Conor McGregor type or what?
No, it's Chad Mendes' fault, to be honest.
Chad Mendes, what?
Damn you, Chad Mendes.
Explain yourself, sir. Chad Mendes.
Because Money Mendes took a fight on 11-day notice and got $500,000 out of it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, everybody sees that. So, you're
attractive. Everybody else should pick up an 11-fight notice.
No, okay, so that was me joking around. You know who's really to blame is the UFC media department, because they, what they need to do is start cutting freak. And if these
start making some better flyers, I agree with you.
Yes.
Well, the issue is that everybody's expecting these guys to talk. Not everybody's Conor McGregor, but if you paint a picture of how unbeatable this guy is, or how freaking of a destroyer he is, I mean, if you improve the to make these guys characters in the promos, for so we can start following them a little bit more or see them in a different light, instead of waiting for them to do the same thing that Conor McGregor does. I think Conor McGregor is one of a kind, and people try to follow that. And some people just I'll give you a great example. Gegard Mousasi, he can't freaking nail it down, and you get this.
Gary Mousasi has it down, bro.
Well, the thing about Mousasi is
one of the best heels I ever seen.
His trash talk is so subtle. You got to catch it. Like, what did he just try? He did just trash talk him. So, I mean.
Well, but that's my point, is that it's very subtle, and it doesn't really capture everything. People aren't talking Mousasi besides Albert Cito.
I can't go anywhere, Guillermo, without talking about Mousasi.
I mean, you can't. That's true. Like, but then you also run into guys who talk trash like GSP, who they just can't, it can't come out. It comes out to, I'm not impressed by your performance.
But that's part. That's his man talk. I like it now when he insults and apologizes in the same sentence.
But I mean, can you guys imagine if, okay, so take GSP for example. If UFC was really like investing in this guy, hey, let's try to get him in this kickboxer movie, right?
Yeah.
During his prime.
Jean-Claude Van Damme.
And then after that, he does that his movie. He comes out of the movie. The GSP is going to be fighting against Nick Diaz, and Nick Diaz, trash talking him left and right. And you have this guy that
GSP.
Yeah, I mean, like you create this storyline, and instead of expecting just the fighters.
So pretty much we always been saying, Guillermo, that they need to embrace the WWE lifestyle when it comes to UFC.
Maybe have before every fight come out, like have a guy like cut a promo behind that, their official logo, have designed a logo like for GSP, or like the McGregor logo, and then cut a promo and then walk out, which would be kind of cool. But I mean, maybe it's just Michael Bisping saying it. So
this is my point. So let's go back to Michael Bisping and Tyron Woodley. Is the problem isn't trying to get a money fight? The problem is that Tyron Woodley and Michael Bisping name alone will not sell out with any other guy amongst them. And if they can't face the reality of that, because Conor McGregor versus a piece of paper in the ring, we will get a freaking awesome matchup no matter what. I love that matchup
already, Guillermo. Book it.
Will Conor McGregor get a paper cut? I mean, let's keep it.
Version? I'm getting it.
I mean, my point exactly. You're going to watch it in HD. where compared to Tyron Woodley versus Stephen Wonderboy, he's complaining about it. When honestly, as a fight fan, I want to see it again.
That's probably the best matchup I want to see.
I'm more excited for that than I want to see. Like, even if Woodley would have fought like guys like Nick Diaz coming back, you don't think Nick Diaz would got a bigger cut than you, Woodley? You know what I mean?
Yeah, come on.
It's just like, it sucks, but I mean, build your reputation first, and then from there you can go. It's like you gotta put some.
And it was
work in
a draw
first.
For crying out loud, a draw. Yeah.
Majority draw.
First, I mean, like McGregor.
Majority draw.
McGregor put it. I think people. I know we're running long here, but. People are thinking that Conor McGregor was an overnight success
when
he
wasn't.
He was talking crap when he was fighting Diego Brandão. Remember?
Yep.
It was like, who's this guy?
I just saw that the other day.
Do you remember like when he was talking crap about like Diego Sanchez? It's like, who's this featherweight? This guy, he keeps running his mouth, and that's how we all saw. And all of a sudden, like he kept winning, and then all of a sudden, everything he said, he started to back up. Yeah. This wasn't an overnight success, and I think guys here are like, I'm a champion now, so I'm gonna get that money now. Which it's a business. And
did everybody forget about Conor McGregor versus Dennis Seaver? That was some. Yeah. I've never seen Dennis Seaver be so mad at someone in my life.
I like how just for people, just a glimpse behind the show. We said we're going to talk about Conor McGregor this show, going
and
over the outline.
And we go overtime
talking about Conor McGregor. So that's it for round number four. We got one more round coming up. We're going to preview the Dennis Bermudez versus Korean Zombie fight. But before we take a break, I want to talk about one of our great partners. Great friends over at FiveBookMMA.com. FiveBookMMA.com is the only place where you'll find real combat sports news from all over the world. A website you can trust with accurate news from MMA, kickboxing, and boxing. news from local promotions to all the major ones like UFC, Bellator, World Series of Fighting, LFA, King of the Cage, PBC, Golden Boy Promotions, Lion Fight Promotions, and many, many more. They also have this great podcast section under where they have a ton of combat sports podcasts, and we're also on there as well. But feel free to listen to all the ones they have featured on their website. It's FiveBookMMA.com. They're also on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, FiveBookMMA.com. Go click on the link. Inform yourself. Round number five coming up. The fifth and final round, UFC Fight Night, Bermudez versus the Korean Zombie, which is actually the villain. They're not even enjoying his name. Bermudez versus the Korean Zombie will take place Saturday, February 4th in the Toyota Center in Houston, Texas, and I will believe air on Fox Sports 1. Yes, it will. Featherweight bout between Dennis Bermudez, Korean Zombie will headline. Also, a women's strawweight bout between Mexico's own Lexi Grasal against Felice Herring. Also on the card, a lightweight bout, James Vick versus Albert Trujillo. You guys remember OSP, Alvin St. Pierre?
Alvin St. Pierre.
He's on this card as well. Yep. Also, I can't. A heavyweight bout between Anthony Hamilton and Marcel Fontuda. And what's up, Guillermo?
I was going to say, I can't forget his tattoo. His, what is it, the horseshoe?
Yeah. Actually, they're actually.
That's isn't that like that one house or something that college kids do? What's it called?
Yeah, it's like a fraternity or a fraternity, yeah.
Whatever. Not into that stuff.
Actually, there's three women's strawweight bouts on this card. There's
And Tisha Torres ain't getting no respect around here.
On the prelim card against Beck Rollins, and also on the main card is Jessica Andrade versus Invicta FC featherweight champion, strawweight champion, sorry, Angela Hill. So, I don't know. Is something up with Joanna Jędrzejczyk? She's trying to find her opponent or what? Or just kind of like just...
Well, she does have a bout coming up. They just haven't announced who she's fighting in. So maybe this is just to clear the picture up.
Yeah, she shot down rumors of Michelle Watterson, actually. She said, no, that's not it. So ooh. I don't know who it can be. I mean,
I was hoping it was the hottie crotty.
I know, after being paid to stamp, but we'll see who they have in store. So, guys, whenever Dennis Bermudez fights, I'm always hyped up just because the guy's like a robot. He just keeps going forward. He drops, but he comes back up again. Yep. And then what is the Korean Zombie known for?
Getting back up.
Getting back up again.
Being exactly what his name says it all, Korean Zombie.
He will not go down. So currently, Bermudez is ranked number 9 in the featherweight division. And where is – I don't think even
– Korean Zombie is not ranked because he's been out of competition for quite some time. Yeah.
So, I mean – other than like, hey, let's put on a wild and crazy show, this doesn't really do much for either guy in the division, right? I mean, Bermudez, if he wins, he kind of stays not, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, it's kind of not fair for Korean Zombie because, first, before I get to my point, the reason they use Korean Zombie because if they use his real name, nobody knows who he is.
Chae Sung-young?
Yeah.
I know exactly who Chae Sung-young is.
It's kind of funny, though.
But with Korean Zombie, it's kind of unfair because he had to serve military time because it's required in South Korea. So that kind of took him out of the UFC fight picture in terms of his ranking. So, you know, coming back in, I mean, it's only fair to put him against the top 10 guys to see where he's at after a 2-year layoff. So I think he is deserving of that ranking, but it also makes sense why he's not ranked anyway to begin with.
Yeah, actually, his last bout with Blues or Not was in 2013 against Jose Aldo.
And, man, was his iron hot. That's what sucks, too, is I think that's when he had the most value. And he had to go for a bit, but
that was about where his arm was like dislocated, right? Yeah. His shoulder was like popped out. Yeah, he was still fighting. Yeah. Dang. Because remember he was put on the map by his bout against Leonard Garcia, and then after that he won 3 in a row and got the title shot against Jose Aldo right in the middle of Jose Aldo's reign. But like you said, unfortunately, well, he had to do what his country asked him to do.
So he did. Because then you go to jail.
Yeah. And then against Bermudez, who has ups and downs, but he's entertaining, right?
I mean, he was on a good streak, had a couple bumps in the road, and now he's back to another streak. So this is a huge matchup for him if he wants to stay relevant, especially because Dennis Bermudez has always gotten so close, but then, you know, one bout takes him away. And he's 30, so now it's the time to go. And I think he needs to win more than Korean Zombie because at least he can make the argument that Korean Zombie has been – gone for so long, and then he literally comes back to such a high competition. So Dennis Bermudez needs to win a lot more than Korean Zombie.
Yeah, Bermudez actually got jumped over by Yair Rodriguez. Actually, he's now number 8.
See,
and pushing out number 9. So there's guys up and coming. So also co-main event, I'm kind of hyped for.
Yes,
there seems to be a nice influx of Mexican fighters, especially on the women's side. For the UFC, strawweight fighter Alexa Grasal will make her second UFC bout against Felice Herring. And I think Grasal, this is in no coincidence that she's from Mexico and she's fighting in Houston, Texas. You know?
Yep.
So I think the UFC kind of likes...
she's undefeated, 23 years old. You know, I feel a little bit bad for Felicia Harding, though, because I feel like there's money there, but it's almost like she's only used to see if the other talent's good.
Yeah.
She's also like just the measuring stick of this women's bout.
Case in point, Paige VanZant. She was kind of Paige VanZant's really first kind of marquee matchup. Yeah,
because even this bout, I feel like... we're not necessarily highlighting Felicia. We just want to see how good Alexa Grasal really is.
Yeah. Also, OSP's on this card. You guys remember him, right?
But
he lost John Jones and he lost to Jimmy Manoa. So hopefully he bounces back and the talent is there. USC Fight Night, Bermudez vs. Korean Zombie, Saturday, February 4th, 2017, Toyota Center, Houston, Texas, on Fox Sports 1. Should be great. I think I'm going to watch this for the main event alone. I mean, I want to see.
I'm going to watch it when Tisha Torres hits the ring. I think she gets deserving enough respect. I think Tisha Torres was one point a really high contender, and I thought she should be the champion.
Yeah.
But I'm going to check that out.
So we'll see. So check that out. That's it for us this week. It is Royal Rumble weekend, so
I got something before we go. What's up? Is Dos Leprechauns T-shirt. You know, if you our good friends at Dos Leprechauns, if you go to their website, they're selling this T-shirt, awesome T-shirt, for $15, I believe. So you know, just to make sure everybody goes checks it out.
Yeah, got good friend Jason Hendricks over there at Dos Leprechauns.
Good plug-in.
Notre Dame, MMA, all that great stuff. Great show. So that's it for us this week. Like I said, it is Royal Rumble weekend. We got to watch. Cameron, who's your pick for the Royal Rumble winner? So we'll talk about next week.
Okay. Well, you want to know now?
Yeah, know now.
Hurry.
I was going to say, it's going to be Roman Reigns.
I got Kenny Omega.
Kenny Omega? First of all, he's horrible. Kenny Omega's under contract. Roman Reigns is fighting for the title, Cameron. Come on.
No, you know what? Okay, I changed my mind then. Strowman.
Get it. All right. Let's end it. What you got?
Bray Wyatt.
That's
it for this week's show. Make sure to Make sure to subscribe to us on iTunes, YouTube, and Podomatic. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at FiveRoundMMA. It's FIVE Round MMA. Like us on Facebook, and please visit FiveRoundMMA.com. Thank you all for listening. We'll see you next week. Albert, what do you got?
Nothing. Just bye.
Oh, yeah, the cream of the crop.